the wise men seek to see and recognize the manifestation of the Lord in our world and in our lives. For the times we have failed to do this, we ask his pardon and forgiveness. I confess
to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts, in my words, in what I have done, in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, our Virgin, all the angels and saints, and to you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Bearing gold and frankincense and proclaiming the praise. graces of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for your benefit, namely, that the mystery was made known to me by revelation. It was not made known to people in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles are co-heirs, members of the same body, and co-partners in the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. The word of the Lord.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of King Herod, behold, Magi from the east arrived in Jerusalem, saying, "Where is the newborn King of the Jews? We saw his star at its rising and have come to do him homage." Herod heard this, he was greatly troubled, and all of Jerusalem with him. Assembling all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They said to him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it has been written through the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, since from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod called the Magi secretly and ascertained from them the time of the star's appearance. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search diligently for the child. When you have found him, bring me word, that I too may go and do him homage." After their audience with the king, they set out. And behold, the star that they had seen at its rising preceded them, until it came and stopped over the place where the child was. They were overjoyed at seeing the star, and on entering the house, they saw the child of Mary, his mother. They prostrated themselves and did him homage. Then they opened their treasures and offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed for their country by another way. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, 33 years ago, I was ordained a deacon. And the first time I ever preached was the Feast of Epiphany. I share a little personal story in this week's bulletin about that. It struck me at that time that everyone who comes to Christ comes to him through someone or something else. The wise men follow the star. Many of us have come to the Lord through parents or someone who's influenced us or introduced us to the Lord in some way. But the infancy narratives tell so much more. Actually, everything that occurs at the birth of Jesus continues throughout his life. And it can be seen at the time he was born. I told you before, the Lord was born in scandal, Mary conceiving without Joseph. Very difficult for earthly-minded people to see him as a savior when he couldn't even save himself. So what happens here on the great feast of Epiphany, which is also called the manifestation of the Lord? Those to whom Jesus came did not recognize him and seemed not to even care. But these foreigners, these non-Jews, these Gentiles, they notice God is doing something. And there is a union between the divine and the human. The symbol of the star is an awakening of divine union. The person of the child shows the human. These three, they search for the divine. But all through Jesus' life, there will be those who who want to thwart God's plan. Herod, Pilate, Caiaphas, the religious leaders and the powerful will always work against him. Herod says, "Oh, when you find out, tell me so I can go worship him." When all the while he wants to kill him. Why? His power is threatened. His prestige is threatened. Why does all of Jerusalem care? Because it's going to cause a change. We don't like change. Shifting sands of power. They didn't like it then either. Then there's those who come to worship and see God. And they give gifts. Why do we exchange gifts? There are some who say, some religious, who say we shouldn't give gifts at all at Christmas time because of all materialism. But that's so foolish. Because we give gifts because God has given us the gift of himself. And in the exchange of true gifts, there is a union of people. Those empty gifts, those gifts that we judge by their value in terms of how much did it cost, or did the person really want to give this to me, or did they feel obligated, and on, that's not gift giving. And we know that experience, it leaves us empty. But when you give a gift, that's an expression of something deep inside. It doesn't really matter what the material thing is. It's the connection between people that matters. So Charlie Brown and his tree. The tree was pretty pathetic. But when the group comes together, they discover the true meaning of Christmas. They see the love behind the gift. So the Magi bring gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Gold symbolizes he's a king. The frankincense, he's divine. The myrrh, that he will suffer and die for us. But the gift also symbolizes something about those who give it. They give the gold, expressing their humanity, their virtue. The frankincense, their desire for the divine, for union with God. And the myrrh, that they're willing to sacrifice. They journeyed far. They spent their time. They gave of themselves. But what does this all mean for us? Jesus was born to die. He was born so that we would not die. He came to save us. What is the most important thing in life? Ultimately, salvation. So, there was this family. They had gathered for a celebration. Christmas, perhaps. And as they were celebrating during their meal conversation, this is before the days of cell phones and iPads and all the rest. People actually talk to each other. So they came up with this idea. The grandfather, maybe because of his age, he said, "I have a question I want you all to answer. How do you want to die?" "Oh, Grandpa, don't ask that question." No. It's something we all have to do, isn't it? How do you want to die? And one person said, "Well, after a long life, I want to die peacefully in my sleep." Sounds pretty good. Another person said, "Oh,
like to die. When I knew I was going to die, so I had time to make amends and gather my family and friends together and tell them how much they mean to me.
Another person said, well, I would like to have a huge party.
And at the end of the party, I'd like to pass peacefully to God.
Well, Grandpa spied his little preteen sitting there, pretty little girl, wasn't saying a word, taking it all in. And he said, Samantha, you haven't said anything. How would you like to die? And her mother went, oh!
Dad, don't say such a
thing. No, everybody has to answer.
And she says, well, I would like to die saving someone else from dying. And her unselfish response stunned everyone. But what stunned them the most was when she added, and I don't mean their body, Grandpa. I mean their soul. Because their soul lives forever. I believe in one God.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
us now together pray our parish prayer.
For today you have revealed the mystery of our salvation in Christ as a light for all nations, when he appeared in our mortal nature, he made us new by the glory of his immortal nature. And so, all the angels and saints, we too give you praise as we raise our voices and acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Strengthen the bond of unity and peace between the faithful, their pastor. Together with Francis, our Pope, David, our Bishop, and all the order of bishops, in a world torn by strife, may your people shine forth as a prophetic sign of unity and peace. Remember our brothers and sisters and all fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to the joy of the light of your face, and in the resurrection, give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us that when our earthly pilgrimage is done, we may enter into a heavenly inheritance in the company of Mary, the Virgin Mother of God, Saint Joseph, your apostles and martyrs, where we too will praise and exalt in the presence of Christ, our risen Lord. Through him, with him, and him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Thank you. body of Christ.
Amen.
Thank you.
with clear sight and revere with true affection the mystery in which you have willed us to participate. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
God is the same today and every day. He always was and always will be. He's present in our midst. May we be wise enough to see him and seek him and honor and adore him. The Lord be with you.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you and keep you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Eucharist is ended. Let us go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Please join in singing our closing hymn.